Hey everybody, this is my thoughts on E3 2016. Sorry it took me so long to get this video out, but I've been rather busy lately with a lot of different things. But why bother explaining things that I do outside of the channel? Let's go ahead and talk about E3. Before I do that, however, I want to mention that the gameplay in the background is of the new Doom, because it's a great microcosm for E3, and by that I mean that everybody acts like it's amazing, and in reality, it's actually extremely underwhelming at best. But anyway, we're going to go ahead and start from the top and work our way down, and by top I mean the stuff that I actually was legitimately interested in and I want to know more about, if not outright get my hands on them. The one game I'm looking forward to most this year is Deus Ex Mankind Divided, and at E3 they showed it basically looks pretty much like Human Revolution on steroids, which is a very good thing because Human Revolution was awesome despite a few pretty significant problems. So I'm definitely still excited for that. Other than Deus Ex, there's also Mirage Arcane Warfare, which is basically like if you took Chivalry and gave it magic, and it looks pretty badass as well. We'll have to wait and see what happens when it comes out, because I'm not sure how the magic is going to affect things, but it looks pretty good so far. Mountain Blade 2. Do I really need to say much about that? I mean, Mountain Blade was one of the big surprises I had when I actually played it and ended up absolutely loving it, and of course, especially Warband. And Bannerlord's a pretty expansive improvement on things if they manage to pull it off, so I'm definitely still looking forward to that. Also coming out this year that I'm absolutely pumped for is Dishonored 2. If you've seen my review of that, you know that I absolutely loved the original Dishonored, and I'm definitely looking forward to the sequel. I'm very glad they showed off gameplay at E3 this year, because it means that not only do they have strong confidence in their product being able to speak for itself, but it also means that we actually got a chance to see what the new Dishonored looks like in terms of gameplay mechanics, and it looks very similar to the original, which is a good thing. Moving on to Warhammer 40,000 Dawn of War 3. If you've seen my reviews of the previous games, you know that I enjoy the hell out of that series, and Dawn of War 3 looks like it combines the best elements from the original game and its expansions, and the elements of Dawn of War 2 that were actually really good, and puts them into something really awesome. However, given how incredibly shaky Company of Heroes 2 was, I'm kind of cautious on that. It still looks awesome, but we'll just have to wait and see when it actually comes out. Then of course there's Titanfall 2, which looks like basically the original Titanfall, but with more stuff in it, which is pretty much exactly what we wanted from it to begin with, so that's good. Obviously, we'll just have to wait and see when it comes out to determine whether or not it's a substantial enough improvement on the original, but for the time being, I'm fairly optimistic about it. The original Titanfall was a pretty good game, despite having a fairly low amount of content. So as long as they keep that strong core and expand upon it and make it better in the sequel, then they'll definitely get a hit on their hands. Just as long as they have things to keep people coming back to it, unlike in the original one. Then of course there's the two games that didn't really get any real E3 presence other than, hey, these are a thing, they're happening eventually, kinda sorta, I guess? And those are Mass Effect Andromeda, which we basically know nothing about other than it takes place in the Andromeda Galaxy quite a long time after Mass Effect 3, and nothing you did in that will matter in this, which is not surprising. But Dragon Age Inquisition proved that BioWare, to some degree, still has it. It's just that you had to get past a sea of EA nonsense to get to it at this point. So we'll just have to wait and see how Andromeda turns out, but consider that one more of a cautious optimism kind of thing. Now the other one is the reboot of Prey, and I still don't know why they felt they had to reboot it, because the original game is now basically going to be forgotten as it was already, which is a real shame because it's one of the most interesting first-person shooters I've played in a very, very long time. And the fact that this new one is trying to do the whole first-person survival horror vibe makes me a bit cautious, but at the same time, it's Arkane Studios and it's Prey coming back. So that kinda outweighs the misgivings I have about it for the time being. We'll just have to wait and see when it actually comes out. And then there was the big surprise of E3 this year, the one game I was not remotely expecting to be interested in. Call of Duty Infinite Warfare, a game that everybody assumed was gonna suck because it's Call of Duty for this particular year, when in reality it looks pretty frickin' awesome. If what they had to say after the fact is to be believed, which I gotta take it with a grain of salt, obviously, but they said that all of that was sort of real time. Obviously, it was pretty scripted in terms of what they were doing, But apparently you can hop into your fighter and fly around and blow up other fighters and stuff, but then you can land wherever you pretty much want to and hop out of the fighter and go for infantry combat, all seamlessly and with open-ended level design. If that's the case, then that would be frickin' awesome and something that this series desperately needs at this point. Obviously, we'll have to wait and see how that plays out, and I can't really see it working very well in a multiplayer context, but at least as far as single player goes, this might be something really interesting. Again, we'll have to wait and see. I'm certainly not going to pick it up for full price, but at least I'm interested in it, which is something I was not remotely expecting to be. And that closes out all of the games that I'm actually legitimately interested in and would really like to play. Notice how few games that was. Yeah, it's only gonna get worse from here on out, everybody, so just bear with me. Next up is the category of things that I just went, eh, whatever, about. Watch Dogs 2. Obviously, I need to finish the first one, and I'm not really enjoying the first one in the slightest. It's just really boring. And I anticipate that Watch Dogs 2 will be much the same in that regard. Scalebound. I have to be in the mood to get into a hack and slash game like that, so obviously if the mood's not striking me, I'm not going to be particularly interested in it. It looks okay, but that's just about any Platinum game, right? Tekken 7. I've never really been a big fan of the Tekken series. They're alright, I have fun playing them, but I've just never been a big fan of them, so I'm not really all that interested. But hey, at least 7's coming to PC, which is something that's pretty cool. And that's not something that Warner Brothers or NetherRealm Studios are doing with Injustice 2. In fact, they're only making it PS4 and Xbox One, which tells me that I have no interest in it, because why would I get a console for one frickin' game? Even if it is Injustice 2, which is the sequel to a game I really did enjoy quite a lot. Sniper Elite 4. I'm just fairly meh toward it because I still need to finish the original Sniper Elite, and I still need to pick up Sniper Elite 3. It's just a matter of being practical about it. Looks alright, though. But anyway, moving on. Mafia 3. I still don't get why people like this series so much. The original game was a total mess, the sequel just was not very good at all, and then you get to this one and it looks like more of the same. Maybe it'll be better than the other ones, but somehow I doubt that. I'll still reserve judgment until I actually get my hands on it, but until then, I'm just looking at it like, eh, whatever. South Park, The Fractured But Whole. Similar problem to Sniper Elite 4. I don't have the Stick of Truth, I have never played the Stick of Truth, so I'm not going to bother with The Fractured But Whole until I've actually played the Stick of Truth. And of course there's Telltale's The Walking Dead Season 3. After how awful Season 2 was, why would I ever be excited about Season 3? I mean, I'll still pick it up and review it at some point, but there's no enthusiasm for the time being on it. And last but not least, Death Stranding. I don't know why people freaked out about this. Oh hey, it's fancy cutscene stuff starring Norman Reedus, and that's it. We know nothing about this thing. At all, other than the fact that it's a Hideo Kojima production and it has Norman Reedus in it. Congratulations, you're getting all hyped up about basically nothing at this point. And speaking about getting hyped up over nothing, let's talk about the low points of E3 this year. There's only four things here. One of them is just a matter of For Honor getting delayed until 2017. While I do appreciate them delaying the game rather than just releasing it in a clearly unfinished state, I really wanted to play it this year. Now I had to bump it back to next year, and that's just depressing. Speaking of depressing, the sheer amount of Windows 10 exclusive, which basically means Windows 10 store exclusive, which means UWP is going to be mandatory, and UWP sucks. Which is one of the major reasons why Quantum Break was a flop on PC. UWP is just a disaster for gaming at this point. Until Microsoft actually gets a clue and either makes UWP not crap or straight up opens it up like they should, then Windows 10 exclusivity is not going to be a good thing. Oh, and just a side note about Windows 10, in case you're wondering, I am going to be taking advantage of the free upgrade thing, but I'm not going to be doing it on Windows 7. I'm going to keep my Windows 7 installation and actually dual boot so I can maintain high compatibility with older stuff on Windows 7 and get the newer stuff on Windows 10. Because let's face it, I run a lot of older programs that barely even work on Windows 7, let alone Windows 10. Anyway, moving on to the other two elements of the low points. Gears of War 4. I don't really know why people are excited about it. It's basically just beating a dead horse. Frankly, it just ended up looking like more Gears of War, and Gears of War, frankly, isn't very good. And then there's the one that everybody freaked out over. Battlefield 1. Ermagerd, it's a World War 1 first-person shooter. Yeah, there's another one out there that's actually historically accurate. It's called Verdun. And while it may not have the production values that DICE can bring to the table with Battlefield 1, at least they actually have the French army in there. I mean, it's not like they were one of the biggest armies fielded in World War I, and now they're being relegated to DLC in Battlefield 1. And I mean, it couldn't hold a candle to the blistering authenticity of everyone and their mother running around with submachine guns or light machine guns in Battlefield 1, where in reality, everyone and their mother ran around with bolt-action rifles. You know, those things that are explicitly written into Battlefield 1 as sniper rifles, not infantry rifles. Oh wait, they have infantry rifles. They're the semi-automatic guns that were actually prototypes in World War I that were barely fielded, if at all. And at this point, you're probably just going, oh, DW, come on, relax. It's a video game. It's a Battlefield game. It's gonna be fun. Well, I don't know about you guys, but a garbage campaign, which is guaranteed because DICE has never made a good single-player game ever, a distinct lack of historical accuracy or even logical accuracy considering that everybody's a bullet sponge in Battlefield anyway, or the simple fact that you can barely even see what you're doing because the visuals are constantly getting in the way, don't really scream, this will be fun to me. Oh yeah, and EA is pulling the whole online code only thing with the PC release, which means that there's no physical disc at all. It's just a download code, and they're obviously going to shut it down whenever they feel like they've gotten their money's worth out of it. At which point you're probably just going, oh, DW is just paranoid. No, they've done it before. In fact, they did it earlier this year with Darkspore. Think about it this way as well. The last game that DICE made was Star Wars Battlefront 2015, which was garbage. And you're actually expecting Battlefield 1 is going to be good? Somehow I get the feeling you're either incredibly naive or just plain old inebriated. And hey, who am I kidding? At some point I'll probably end up with a copy of it and I'll review it, much like I'm eventually going to review Battlefield Hardline even though I said I probably wasn't going to do that. But hey, I got a couple of the DLCs for free and I figured why let those go to waste if I can get the game itself for dirt cheap and actually at least get something out of it. But in Battlefield 1's case, I'll probably just do the smart thing and wait until the inevitable full version comes out where all of the DLCs are included because, let's face it, EA loves their nickel and diming. Oh, and speaking of nickel and diming, we are now in the, oh, come on, category of stuff, where I was just sitting there watching the conferences, and whenever something in this category came up, I was like, oh, come on, you have to be kidding me. The first of these is what everybody would expect, The Elder Scrolls V Skyrim Remastered. It's just Bethesda trying to cash in on the current gen of consoles and putting basically no effort whatsoever into it. For some baffling reason, people would still buy Skyrim on the new consoles, even though it's the exact same damn game, and you can get it on PC for cheaper, and by modding it, make it look infinitely better than anything Bethesda could have crapped out on that engine. And the sad part is, people will buy it for some baffling reason. And that's just incredibly depressing. You know what else is depressing? Ghost Recon Wildlands. When I was watching that, I was like, oh great, it's yet another Ubisoft open world game. Good job, you've ruined Ghost Recon now. And speaking of ruining things, Bethesda saw fit not just to ruin Doom, but now they're gonna ruin Quake as well with Quake Champions, which is basically a MOBA style of Quake. At least that's what it sounds like, and what that means is basically they're extending both middle fingers to pretty much anybody who was actually a fan of Quake. Oh, and speaking of middle fingers, Resident Evil 7. This is a middle finger to anyone with anything resembling common sense. Capcom just will not let this series die. You would have thought that Resident Evil 6 was a wake-up call for them, and especially now that they've released Umbrella Corps and it has been completely panned across the board, you would think they would get a hint eventually, but apparently they don't. I'm just baffled by that. Another thing I'm baffled by is the abundance of zombie games even at E3 this year. Yes, we're getting Dead Rising 4 and the guy from the first Dead Rising's back. Whoop-dee-doodle-frickin'-doo. I still haven't played any of the Dead Rising games. I own Dead Rising 2, but I haven't played it yet because it's a zombie game and I'm so incredibly sick of zombies that I have no interest in it. Speaking of things that I'm sick of, shoehorning VR into just about everything. Sure, we get it, VR's a cool gimmick right now, but that's it, it's just a gimmick right now. Until you develop experiences specifically for VR that actually are enhanced significantly by it, then you're not really gonna get much out of it other than, oh hey, this is kinda neat. There's a similar issue with Project Scorpio, which is basically just if you took an Xbox One and made it capable of speeding out crap at 4K. Look, we get it, 4K is the future, but who really gives a crap other than graphics aficionados? At the moment, there is basically no reason whatsoever to be interested in 4K output unless you are on the bleeding edge, and that is so few people that it doesn't even really matter. The vast majority of people are still using 1080p or 1440p at most, and even on 1440p, most of our hardware is not really capable of rendering it full stop. That's something that cards like the GTX 1070 are trying to fix. They're trying to make everything 1440p ready, and ATI's cards are doing pretty much the same thing, or AMD. I still call them ATI for some reason. AMD's cards are doing pretty much the same thing at this point. They're targeting more 1440p and 1080p than they're targeting 4K, except on their highest end cards. And that's because they know that nobody's really going to be all that interested in 4K until the cost comes down enough on the monitors and on the hardware in order to be able to actually run 4K. And while the monitors are starting to get into that range, they're really not quite there yet. We still don't have any 4K monitors that can do anything higher than 60Hz, and so the people who are like me and are more performance-minded aren't really going to be all that interested in them. At least not until we start getting 120Hz, 144Hz 4K monitors, and the hardware that is capable of actually rendering them at such, as opposed to barely getting 60fps at best. But then again, something like Project Scorpio is not really made for someone like me. It's made for the people who seem to think 4K is amazing and should be standard. Maybe it should be standard in a while, but right now 1080p is fine and 1440p is pretty much the sweet spot. Like I said, I'll be waiting for 4K until we actually get stuff that works really, really well with 4K. Now, moving on to the handful of other things that are in the oh come on category. Trials of the Blood Dragon. Let's face it, we all wanted more of Blood Dragon. After having played Far Cry 3 Blood Dragon and found it absolutely fantastic, we wanted more of that. What we're getting instead is Trials with a Blood Dragon skin. I am mind-bogglingly disappointed by this. I seriously have less than no interest in the Trials series, and throwing a Blood Dragon skin on it doesn't make me suddenly want to play them. Similarly, I didn't like the Gwent minigame in The Witcher 3, but everybody else seemed to think it was the best thing ever, and so now it's getting its own standalone game. But you know what? That's both a good and a bad thing. It's good that the people are getting what they want. It's bad in that the people who were actually interested in things like, oh, I don't know, Cyberpunk 2077 get to sit here while all you Gwent people get to frolic in the fields with your wonderful CCG, and we get to sit here going, hey, is Cyberpunk 2077 actually happening, or what? I'm only slightly bitter, in case you can't tell. But anyway, moving on to the only other two things left in this category, there is Day of Infamy, which is basically Red Orchestra, and at that point I'm just like, why are they even bothering to make this? And then there's Halo Wars 2. I still don't know why people are excited about this, I guess because it's a major real-time strategy game. Too bad the original Halo Wars might well be the worst real-time strategy game I've ever played. You may think that I'm exaggerating, that, oh, come on, DW, there's worse strategy games you've played, right? No, there really aren't. Not even something like Dragonthrone Battle of Red Cliffs is as unbelievably terrible as Halo Wars was. And that game barely even friggin' works. Halo Wars works. It's just terrible. I'm going to review it at some point and point out that it is the exact reason you should never, ever make a real-time strategy game for console. It does not work. Notice me being specific there and saying real-time strategy, because you can actually make turn-based strategy work on console. You just can't make real-time strategy work on it. But anyway, then there's the one last thing that I saw at E3 2016, and it has its own category. And that category is F*** you. What in the living hell did they do to The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild? They took a game series that was extremely well established, and established for pretty much all the right reasons, and they took a good chunk of that and said, you know what? We don't care anymore. We're gonna throw that into the wood chipper because innovation! Open world Zelda, I'm perfectly fine with. They're pretty much open world anyway. But when you compromise the very tightly woven experience of a Zelda game, where every single item has its purpose, and every single item has its own purpose in solving the puzzles of every single dungeon in the game, then you're basically saying you have absolutely no idea what actually works in the Zelda form. This is a problem that started to rear its ugly head with Twilight Princess in particular, and it seems like the series has just gone down the crapper since then. While I have yet to play it, Skyward Sword, from everything I've heard, everything that I've seen, looks downright terrible, and I can confirm that the two on DS, Phantom Hourglass and Spirit Tracks, were terrible. But instead of looking at those games and saying, hey, what did we do wrong? How can we fix that? It looks like they looked at them and said, you know what? What's really not working is we aren't changing things up enough. Let's throw crap out the window for no reason at all. And you know what Zelda really needs? Equipment degradation and tons of generic equipment. That sounds fantastic. I don't know about you guys, but I don't play Zelda games to play what is basically a crappier, more family-friendly version of Dark Souls. I play them to get the proper Zelda experience, and I haven't really gotten that since Twilight Princess, and even Twilight Princess's Zelda experience was a bit strained at times. Add to that the fact that the new Zelda is going to be simultaneously released on Wii U and the new NX, and you basically have Nintendo admitting that the Wii U is a failure. So, good job, Nintendo. You royally screwed up. Seriously, if you somehow manage to make a Zelda game look awful, then you have completely failed. Even as crappy as Phantom Hourglass and Spirit Tracks are when you actually play them, when they were showing them off, they still looked all right. Skyward Sword, regardless of whatever messes it may well have, at least looked really cool when they were showing it off. Breath of the Wild, on the other hand, just looks like a desperate attempt to get people back on the Nintendo bandwagon by whatever means necessary, and it certainly didn't work in my case. In fact, it pretty much made me want to jump ship on Nintendo. I mean, to give you an idea, the last Nintendo system I bought was a Nintendo DS. I haven't bought a Wii, I haven't bought a Wii U, and I haven't bought a 3DS, even though I do want to get a 3DS at some point. But honestly, the only reason I would even get a Wii U at this point is because of backwards compatibility with Wii games. That's it. When not even a Zelda game can get me excited about Nintendo, you know you got a serious problem on your hands. So that's E3 this year, a bunch of boundless hype for basically nothing that's actually worth hyping up. I mean, hell, Sony even showed off a new God of War game, which is really funny considering they already killed off all the Greek gods, so where can they go from there? Oh wait, I guess we gotta do Norse now because we ran out of Greek gods to kill. I guess far be it from them to actually come up with some new ideas instead of just rehashing the same old damn crap over and over and over again. Anyway, yeah, that was E3 this year. I was very thoroughly unimpressed with it, much as I am extremely thoroughly unimpressed with the new Doom. In fact, I'm kind of hating it. And the more I play it, the more it pisses me off. And before you start to bitch about how, oh, DW must just suck at the game, I had to bump the difficulty up to Nightmare because Ultra Violence was too easy. But I'll save all that for the actual Doom 4 review. Do not ask me when it's coming out, I do not have an ETA for you. It's being worked on, it's going to happen when it happens. But anyway, I got my little announcement about the Doom 4 review out of the way, and now my E3 video is there, and if you want to discuss more things about E3, certainly feel free to do so in the comments. Things that were announced, things that you may want me to clarify more of, that sort of thing. But until next time, I will catch you guys in later videos.